Hi, everybody, and welcome to our webinar today. My name is Eddie Amin, and I am joined by three distinguished colleagues who will be here to talk to you about student loans, student debt, and sort of managing a budget during this unprecedented time. I wanted to share a couple of resources with you just as we get started. So our webinar today is Budgeting and Repaying Student Loans in a Pandemic. It's one of the first in a series that we're presenting to you from the American Psychological Association. Again, a few of us are from APA. Of course, we're speaking to you live from our bedrooms in this new world we're in. I want all of our attendees to know that you're welcome to ask questions throughout this presentation. So if something comes to your mind that a panelist is discussing, please go to the questions box in your GoToWebinar panel, and that's just going to be above the handout section of the dashboard. A copy of the recording will also be sent to all registrants, along with a survey about this webinar. If you stay on the webinar long enough, you'll also be prompted to take the same survey. It's going to help us understand a little bit more about the financial impact that COVID-19 is having on your personal and professional life. It'll also help us figure out what other webinars and resources APA should focus on developing. So we'd appreciate your feedback there. We're keeping this to an hour. Let me, at the top level, begin by telling you, if you haven't seen this website already, we've got a tremendous set of resources that's recently been updated and organized into several different audience areas. So if you go to the APA.org homepage and then click the COVID-19 topic page, you'll be taken to a great set of resources for students, early career psychologists, for faculty, for practicing psychologists, and for the general public. One of the things that my office has the pleasure of developing is a webinar series that we're going to be featuring on successive Wednesdays at noon Eastern. It's staying on track during a pandemic, mainly focused on the needs of students and early career psychologists, but open and welcoming to all in psychology and our allies. There's a typo on the website, but it's pages with an S, pages plural, .apa.org/staying-on-track. That is where you can register for future webinars. By the end of this week, we'll have additional registrations up, including one that we're almost certain will be next Wednesday at noon. It's going to be on completing your dissertation from your living room. And then in successive webinars, we'll have presentations on completing your doctoral internship and getting licensed as a health service psychologist. We'll also be talking about pivoting your research. And a couple of other topics are also in the works. So we're really excited to bring that to you. We asked you when you pre-registered to tell us how COVID-19 was impacting you personally and professionally. We hope to do an article that more carefully looks at these responses, but just for the sake of normalizing the situation that you might be experiencing, this is a word cloud that we put together from those responses. So some of the bigger words are indicating a frequency of concern, including having a significant impact on your job, on your life as a student, on your income, on your loans, unemployment, and making and meeting your bills on perhaps a limited salary. Given that many of us are in this boat right now, I don't want to waste any more time. I'm going to turn it over to our first panelist. Let me introduce them all as a whole. They're Kenneth Polishchuk. He is Senior Director of Congressional and Federal Relations at the American Psychological Association. I work with Kenneth pretty regularly. He is my educator when it comes to what education policy issues are impacting our students and early career professionals. We'll then turn it over to Alex Maslach. He's the Manager of Business Development and Partnerships at Laurel Road. Laurel Road is a new partner to APA, and it provides financial resources and loan products to borrowers. We'll then close out our panelists with Bobby Hoyt. He's a friend of APA and has done several webinars and articles in the past before. He's a freelance writer He's also the creator of millennialmoneyman.com. It's a website I encourage you to check out for some of its more recent content related to coping during COVID-19. Again, I'm Eddie Amin. I oversee the Office's Early Career and Graduate Student Affairs, and I'll be your moderator today. So without further ado, I'm going to invite Kenneth to talk about what we're seeing from Capitol Hill and how these new policies that have been signed into law will impact current students and current borrowers.
Great. Thanks a lot, Eddie, and thanks everyone for joining us today. So I will go over some of the provisions in the recently enacted CARES Act, which are focused specifically on student financial assistance and federal student loans. I'll also provide an overview of who's eligible, how the Department of Education intends to implement the law, and what the impacts will be on students and borrowers. And finally, I'll give a brief overview of what some of the next steps that Congress is considering. So the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security, or CARES Act, provides $30 billion for an education stabilization fund, including $14 billion for higher education emergency relief. And the Department of Education has begun disbursing some of these funds last week. The bill also provides protections for low-income students on federal financial assistance programs. That includes federal work study and Pell Grants. It also includes a provision that applies to employer assistant loan repayments, and that would make them tax deductible for the first time. Currently, those repayments are only in terms of tuition assistance, and this would not be permanent. However, it expires on January 1st, 2021, unless Congress decides to extend it in any future legislation. And finally, the bill would also defer federal student loan payments, including interest, for a period of 6 months. And that's what we'll talk about next. Next slide, please. Great, thank you. So all of these actions are automatic. So you don't have to actually take any action on your own to receive these benefits. And you should, in fact, have already received notification from your loan servicer. If you have not, I would encourage you to check their website for more information and see if these changes are reflected in your account. So in terms of timing, it's retroactive to March 13th, which is the start of the national emergency associated with COVID-19, and it will run through September 30th. All loans that are eligible are, you know, all federal loans that are held by the Department of Education. However, there are some loans that are not, including some FFELL and Perkins loans, the FFELL loans that are commercially held and the Perkins loans that are held by institutions of higher education, and private loans. In terms of the FFELL and Perkins loans that are ineligible, there are about 10 million borrowers who have those loans. You can take advantage of the current action in the CARES Act if you have those loans. You would have to consolidate them, however. However, once this current period ends, the interest rate may become higher than what you're currently paying for the on those loans. So it's something that you should keep in mind if you choose to do so. In terms of interest rates, they will be set at zero for the duration of this period. And in that time period, also interest will not accrue on those loans. So all payments, including any automatic payments, will be suspended through this period. And, you know, if you've made any payments between March 13th and when the CARES Act was signed into law on March 37th, you will be reimbursed for those payments. How the department is doing that is that they will automatically apply any interest paid in that time period to the principal of your loan once all the interest that accrued before March 13th is paid off. And you can also request a full refund for any payments that you made in that retroactive period, but you will have to do that by contacting your loan servicer. Next slide. So you can also opt to make payments during this time period, and similar to the retroactive piece, any payments that will be made between March 13th and September 20th will be applied to the to your principal once all the interest is paid off prior to March 13th. In order to do this, you would have to contact your servicer and inform them that you would like to continue making payments, and you can. All of these actions also apply to any defaulted loans. So the department cannot currently, they can garnish wages or tax refunds or social security benefits on any of the defaulted loans during this period. And any suspended payments will also count towards rehabilitation of defaulted loans. Once it comes time to restart your payments, your loan servicer should notify you sometime in August with a reminder that they will be going back into effect on, you know, starting October 1st. Next slide. You know, I know that many of our students and early career professionals are either considering or in the Public Service Loan Forgiveness Program. And so a very good sort of benefit from this legislation is that any of the suspended payments that will occur during this 6-month period will still count towards borrowers' progress in PSLF as well as any other federal loan forgiveness programs. So in some respects, this will actually effectively lower the number of payments that you need to make under PSLF because all of these quote non-payments will still be counted. So for example, currently you're required to make 120 payments in order to qualify for PSLF, but if these 6 months worth of payments are indeed counted, which they will and should be, you would only have to make then 114 payments under PSLF. And so furthermore, any borrowers that are enrolled in income-driven repayment plans, which everyone who is in PSLF will have to be enrolled in one of those plans, if your deadline for annual recertification of income comes up during this period, that will also be suspended for 6 months. Next slide. So what can you do to stay proactive in all of these matters? What I would suggest is save any and all correspondence that you have either with your loan servicer or with the Department of Education. In case there are any kind of discrepancies or a dispute will arise, you will have that documentation saved to be able to use it to in the event of that occurring. Also make sure to keep your contact info and up to date. So loan services will be sending out emails periodically on any kind of actions that they're taking. So you want to make sure that your contact info is current so they'll be able to reach you if they need to. I would also suggest checking your loan services website and the Department of Education website periodically in case you've missed an email or any kind of mailing that you receive from them, and they will be posting updates on their website. So it's good to just kind of keep up to date on what is happening. And lastly, particularly if you're still a current student and if you're maybe graduating during this loan suspension period, contact your student financial aid office on campus. They're a good resource for you. They have a lot of information. And they'll be, you know, knowing full well that they're probably stretched quite thin during this period because there's a lot of issues that they're addressing, but they're still a resource for you and you should try to use them as much as you can. Next slide. There are two other pieces that I wanted to go over in CARES that aren't necessarily student loan related, but could have an impact on many of you on the call. The first one is the direct payments to taxpayers. So they start, you know, the payments started going out, I think, last week to the first cohorts. In order to qualify for these payments, you will have to be either a U.S. citizen or a legal resident. You will have to have a Social Security number. You cannot be counted as a dependent on anyone else's tax return. And you would have to have filed a 2018 or a 2019 tax return. And in terms of eligible amounts, so single filers with an adjusted gross income of $75,000 or less will receive $1,200. And married taxpayers filing jointly with an adjusted gross income of $150,000 will receive $2,400. So the amount of the check will increase, will decrease by $5 for every $100 that the adjusted gross income exceeds either one of those two amounts. And if you do have dependents, you're able to also receive $500 for each dependent who is 16 years old or younger. And as I said, the IRS has began sending out the first payments this week. And if you have a direct deposit already set up with the IRS, you're going to probably receive that payment quicker. Because if you do not, they will have to mail you a check. From my understanding, the IRS is setting up a website this week that will allow you to go in and check the status of the checks that are being mailed to you, and also update any kind of mailing information if you believe that it isn't up to date. And then the second piece here is unemployment benefits. So what the CARES Act does is that it actually increases the unemployment benefit for individuals receiving unemployment compensation by $600 a week for a period ending July 31st, 2020. And for those who have exhausted all of their benefits under the regular unemployment program will also be eligible to receive up to 13 weeks of additional benefits. And this will be retroactive to starting March 29th. Next slide, please. Okay, yeah. So in terms of some of the next steps that Congress is considering, there's already a fourth stimulus bill being worked on as we speak. So two particular issues in terms of student loans that are being talked about is extending the same CARES Act provisions to those previous loans that I had mentioned that aren't currently eligible. So that would impact, like I said, about 10 million borrowers. And then also potentially including some form of a larger loan forgiveness piece. So there's been talks of at least $10,000 worth of forgiveness. And that was, you know, when the CARES Act was being negotiated, that was proposed. And some have even proposed up to at least $30,000 worth of forgiveness. Senators Brown and Warren have also called on private lenders to suspend private student loan payments. That has not happened at the moment, although I believe I saw some reporting this last week that in New York State, that might be happening for New York State borrowers. And there have also been several bills introduced that would address some of the student loan and repayment issues. One particular piece of legislation introduced by Mitt Romney in the Senate would allow students who graduated between January 21st, 2020 and December 31st, 2020 to defer all federal student loan payments for up to 3 years. And a bipartisan bill has been introduced, a companion one in the House as well. And so there is a possibility of that also being included potentially as a provision in the next stimulus package. And there's also a public service loan forgiveness related legislation in the Senate that would waive the requirement that a borrower make monthly payments under PSLF during a qualifying emergency in the state in which the borrower is employed. Now, currently under CARES, any suspended payments also apply to PSLF progress. However, this potentially could go longer than the 6 month period that is currently in law. In terms of timing, it's still unclear when this fourth stimulus bill will be considered, mainly because it's still not exactly known when Congress will come back into session. Right now they've pushed back their return date to May 4th, but that could go even further. So if they don't return, any kind of legislation that's passed would have to be done through unanimous consent, which with a bill this large, it would be difficult to really get everyone on board remotely. So most likely they will have to wait until Congress is back in session in Washington to pass this legislation. But negotiations still continue in that period, and APA continues to be very active in pushing our priorities, including on a lot of these student-related issues with members of Congress. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Kenneth. I know that we'll get some questions for you that came in from pre-registration, so we'll be back in touch in just a short while after our next two panelists. At this point, I would like to welcome Alex Maislach again. He's coming to us from Laurel Road, which is a partner with APA and is offering a reduced interest rate for people that are interested in borrowing or continuing to borrow and repay their loans in the private market. Alex, if you are here and you're able to share your slides, I'm going to go ahead and try to do that, switch you over as presenter.
Sure. Great. Okay. Able to see the slides now?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, Eddie, for organizing this. And thanks, Kenneth, for that really detailed overview of how the CARES Act is helping student loan borrowers. I even learned some things at the end of those slides. So I'm sure that was really helpful for everybody. I'm going to talk a bit about Laurel Road, our partnership with the APA, and some of the details of those federal repayment options, as well as what we do at Laurel Road, which is student loan refinancing. So the basic concept here is outside of this interest waiver for the next 6 months as part of the CARES Act, typically you have an opportunity to refinance your federal student loans to a lower interest rate once you graduate and have begun practicing. Obviously, this is a different time right now, especially with this 0% interest waiver taking place for the next 6 months. So the likelihood that refinancing a federal loan right now is in your best interest is probably low. We'll talk more about that, but there's also probably never been a better time to refinance a private loan you may have, as the ones you take out while you're in school generally are at higher interest rates, and we're at a historically low interest rate environment. So what you could qualify for right now maybe a good deal lower. So I'll talk more about that. I don't need to go into much detail on what the CARES Act entails for student loan borrowers. Kenneth, again, did a really good job of that. I would just add, you know, if you were looking for some more information on it, there's a good deal on the link at the bottom of the screen here, studentaid.gov/announcements-events/coronavirus. All the program details are there. You know, ultimately, this is unprecedented in the student loan world. So typically, these programs do evolve fairly frequently over the years. You know, I'll show you, you know, some more slides here. Income-driven repayment has changed leaps and bounds over the last 6 or 7 years. You know, but it's not frequent that you see something so generous to borrowers, you know, which is really necessary in light of the times. But not during the housing crisis. At no other point in student loan history has the federal government taken a step to, you know, not only allow you to stop making payments, but to not be charged interest as well. So, you know, those of you who do have federal loans right now, you're well positioned to take advantage of this program. So I'll go into some more detail on the actual functions of, you know, some popular federal repayment programs. Kenneth mentioned direct consolidation. For those of you who have some FFELP loans or Perkins loans, this might be your first step to taking advantage of that 6 month interest and payment waiver. Any consolidation done at this point with the Department of Education is going to yield a direct loan. And it's those direct loans which are eligible for the interest waiver and payment waiver. These are also the only loans which are eligible for public service loan forgiveness. So if that's a program you're intending to pursue, first step would likely be to consolidate your federal loans, or at least the ones which aren't already direct loans, in order to make them eligible for, again, both the CARES Act interest waiver as well as public service loan forgiveness. Income-driven repayment is a really popular repayment option, especially for folks coming right out of school, but also those who have been out, you know, potentially 5-10 years. It's These are programs which allow you to make payments based solely on your income and family size, as opposed to what you owe. So instead of, you know, paying based on your six-figure debt burden, you can pay on, you know, what's perhaps a more modest starting salary, you know, right out of school. So there's three versions of income-driven repayment. There's income-based repayment. That's the oldest of all these programs. There's pay-as-you-earn, and then revised pay-as-you-earn, which are the two newest income-driven options. These programs are going to have you pay either 10 or 15% of your discretionary income towards your loans. So discretionary income is calculated by taking your adjusted gross income from your tax return, and then you subtract 150% of the poverty line for your family size. And that's how they arrive at discretionary income. So either 10 or 15% of that is what's going to go towards the loans on a monthly basis. So generally yields a more manageable monthly payment. You know, to give you some context, if you, you know, let's say earned a $70,000 salary in the prior year, 10% of that, you could expect to be paying, you know, somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 a month, depending on your family size. So a more manageable amount than, you know, a standard payment, if you had $150,000 in debt, it's probably something more like $1,500 a month. So some good liquidity relief is available through these programs. Obviously, that's not the primary concern right now with the payment waiver. But you know, once we're past this, these programs can provide you some additional liquidity. They do have a forgiveness component built in and of themselves. So separate of that public service loan forgiveness, if you pay in these for either 20 or 25 years, depending on the program, at the end of that time, whatever's remaining on the loan gets forgiven. The caveat with this forgiveness is it's taxable. So, you know, theoretically you pay for 20 years and pay as you earn, and there's 50 grand left on the loan. It'll get forgiven, but it'll be as though you earned $50,000 in that tax year. So you'd have to pay a bill, tax bill on it that year. So, you know, it doesn't necessarily negate its value, but it's definitely a consideration in determining, you know, do you want to try and stretch this loan out and get it forgiven, you know, over 20 or 25 years. Another federal program, which is particularly pertinent to a lot of healthcare professionals, frankly, is public service loan forgiveness. So the idea here is if you work at a nonprofit or government entity for 10 years, you can make qualifying payments, and at the end of that 10 years, whatever's left on a loan gets forgiven, and this is totally tax-free. So there's no tax implications whatsoever. The debt is just wiped clean off of your balance sheet. I think there's a lot of misconception out there about this program, that you have to work in a rural or underserved area to qualify. In fact, it's all about positioning your loans and your employment such that, you know, you're eligible for the forgiveness event. So four boxes you got to check. Number one, only federal direct loans are eligible. Private loans do not qualify. That's something to be aware of. And then you use those income-driven repayment programs to pursue public service loan forgiveness. Thirdly, work full-time at a 501c3, so that's a nonprofit or a government entity. Full-time, they classify as 30 hours a week. And then 120 monthly payments. So you can't accelerate payments. You can't pay ahead and get to the forgiveness earlier. It does have to be the full 10 calendar years in order to reach the forgiveness point. So incredibly valuable program, especially if you, you know, are working and you're confident you're going to continue to work at a qualifying facility. Ultimately, nothing better than, you know, making minimum payments based on your income and getting, you know, whatever's left forgiven after 10 years. So I would certainly, you know, look into if you're working at a facility that would qualify for this. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about federal repayment versus refinancing, similarities, differences, and I'll try and be concise here given the time. Federal loans in general are more flexible. And certainly right now, you know, you have that interest waiver and payment waiver for the next 6 months, which is not available from private lenders. So given the times, federal loans are particularly attractive. And like I said at the beginning of this presentation, most people are going to be best served to keep their federal loans federal. But refinancing can be really attractive for those who have private loans or who have, you know, other types of loans which might not qualify for those interest waiver options. So I won't talk through every one of these differences, again, just based on the time, but I'll give you a second to sort of digest here. Again, the overall message is when you refinance, you're giving up a number of federal benefits in exchange for a lower interest rate on the loan. So, you know, if your federal rate is 6.5-7%, well, you know, a good refinance rate is probably 4-5%. So you can, you know, shave 2-3% off of that rate. Obviously, things are complicated now, again, with the federal interest waiver, but in more normal times, you know, taking that lower interest rate is going to save tens of thousands over the life of the loan. And likely will be a really attractive option once that, you know, 6-month interest waiver ends. So talk a little bit about refinancing with Laurel Road. We do offer APA members a quarter point rate discount. So whatever rate you would receive coming to us, you know, without being an APA member, it's going to be reduced by a quarter point, so 0.25% from that. So if you would have gotten 5% off the street, you know, you'd get 4.75 by virtue of being affiliated with the APA. I mentioned the savings opportunity. We do offer up to 12 months of forbearance on all of our loans, and we're actually offering an additional 3 months in light of the COVID pandemic. So if you had a loan with us, currently you can call, you know, very streamlined process, more so than it typically is, and we'll put that loan on hold for an additional 3 months on top of the 12 that come with the loan. This is totally free to do. There's no application fees, no closing costs, nor are there prepayment penalties. So if you wanted to pay the loan back quicker with some overpayments, you're certainly welcome to do that. So I'll wrap things up here before turning it over to Bobby, and hopefully we'll have some time for questions. I know there were quite a few, but the historically low interest rate environment is definitely something to be aware of. Generally, as the economy goes, so too does interest rates. So when the economy is doing really well, interest rates tend to go up. As the economy struggles, looks like we might have lost the screen share there, but interest rates go down. So when you have the economy struggling as it is right now, we see rates go down to where they are right now with at historical lows. The 10-year treasury is near 0%. And so if you were thinking about refinancing a private loan, or in some cases a federal loan, now would be, you know, really an optimal time to do so. There isn't much room for interest rates to go any further down. So you can, you know, feel a good degree of confidence that you're getting about as good a rate as you could qualify for. So with that, I will turn it back over. And I think Bobby is going to talk a little bit about some optionality as well.
Thank you so much, Alex, for giving us some great information just now. I've got some questions for you as well that we'll be coming back to after Bobby gives his presentation. So without further ado, our third of three panelists today, everybody, is Bobby Hoyt. He's going to be providing some financial expertise and telling you about some of the things that he's been looking into to help people who have really significant and pressing financial questions during this pandemic. Go ahead, Bobby. Lucia will be able to show you your slides. Yeah.
So, you know, hope everybody's doing well. Hope everybody's staying safe. You know, thanks, Alex, Kenneth, great information. So my goal here for everybody that's watching is really just to give you some tools to use right now. As far, I know a lot of people looking through the questions that we received before the webinar, I know a lot of you are struggling right now. I feel for you. You're definitely not going through this alone. There's a lot of people struggling. So before I kind of get into it, I just want you to know that you shouldn't feel bad about being caught off guard by this. I think there's, you know, just from a lot of things I've seen on Twitter and news stories and things like that, there's a lot of, you know, well, people should have been more prepared. And I don't think that anybody could necessarily prepare for this. I don't think anybody saw this coming, obviously, and to the depth that we've seen. So that's the first thing I just want you to know. You should not feel guilty about being caught off guard by any of this. And there are tools that can help. So that's my goal here. Just a little bit about me. I've been writing for the APA for several years now, personal finance content. If you check out the site and you read any of the content, you've probably seen me around. I also have been running Millennial Money Man. It's a personal finance website. I've been doing that professionally since 2015. And I'm also a Forbes contributor and I've been in a lot of different places. So you're more than welcome. Everything that I'm going to talk about, there's content on millennialmoneyman.com where we've covered this in depth. Either me or somebody from the team, where we've written about stimulus checks or what to do if you can't make your if you've been furloughed. And so if you just go to millennialmoneyman.com/blog, you're going to see all of the content that's kind of coronavirus related. So let's go ahead and get into it. My main goal here is to give you again some tools to help you through this time and help you manage your money through this time. So if we could go to the first slide. So the first thing, we talk about budgeting a lot in the personal finance world, but this is the time, I know a lot of you are probably feeling like you don't want to look at your bank accounts and you don't want to look at your the bills that are coming in. But I would really encourage you to take this opportunity to really dial in what is going on with your personal finances. And if you haven't made a budget, this is the time to start one. And I'm going to give you some tools for that. But if you are in a position where you really need to cut things quickly, I want you to start with an emergency budget. So it's a little bit different than your normal, kind of monthly budget when things are good. The emergency budget, we're just going to focus on cutting things that we don't need, right? And just to give you some ideas, for subscription services, and this is for convenience items, right? If I'm going to say food delivery services, if you have, some kind of food allergy, or if you have some kind of dietary need that you get a service, obviously use your discretion, don't cut that. But, if you use food delivery services for convenience or shave clubs, or, clothing boxes, this would be the time to cut those. And you can always go back to them later. it's not something that's going to be forever. So, I would start cutting those if you can, and kind of looking at your expenses and seeing where you can save some money there. Takeout is a big one. And I know that this is kind of like a catch-22 for everybody, because we all want to support our small businesses and the local restaurants that we love going to, but you can't do it at the expense of your own finances, right? So, if you can, do takeout and all of that, great. But that's one of the things I would try to cut out immediately, just because, if you're doing DoorDash or anything like that, you're paying more money just for the food to come in. So that's something I would take a look at. Entertainment costs, I would look at if you're paying for, let's say, Netflix and Hulu at the same time, right? I would start trying to cut streaming services where you can. You can definitely check out the free streaming concerts, check out what your library offers. There's a lot of free things to do right now, so I would encourage you to do that. I know that something my wife and I are doing, we're taking way more walks than we have ever taken in our life. So, I would start trying to look for free things to do, and just to get outside a little bit more if you can. And then, groceries, and this is kind of a no-brainer sometimes, but I think you need to look at what you're getting at the grocery store, really meal plan it out. Don't go in there without a plan, because you're going to spend more money. And then the big thing, after all of that being said, one of the things and one of the issues that most people have with their personal finances, they don't really know exactly where all of their money is going, especially right now. If you've had, your pay cut, or if you've lost your job, you need to know what is on your credit cards that you might not remember, the service that you signed up for, or the thing you're paying for every month that just kind of is like a vampire drain on your bank account. So my recommendation, if you haven't started budgeting, or if you're looking for a place to do that, I use Mint. And you can go to mint.com. It's a free tool, and basically what it does is it connects to your bank accounts. It pulls all of your transactional information in, and you can see in all in one place every single transaction that is happening every month. And you can start to look through and cut some of those things as needed. And you'll learn a lot about your finances. It'll help you a lot. So that's the tool I use. Again, it's 100% free. There are some other budgeting tools like You Need a Budget or YNAB. If you go to YNAB.com, they have a 34-day free trial. After that, it's paid. It's one of the only paid tools that I recommend for budgeting, but it's really, really good. There's also Every Dollar, which is a kind of like a Dave Ramsey, if you've heard of him. That's his team put out Every Dollar. It's also a great budgeting app. And then there's also Excel spreadsheets, Quicken. Right, there's lots of different ways to do it. Pen and paper, it doesn't really matter how you like doing a budget, or what appeals to you. There's something for everyone. And if you go to millennialmoneyman.com, you can search any of the things I just talked about: Mint, YNAB, Excel budget spreadsheets. We have all of those, and we've done reviews on everything, so you can get a good look at how all of that works. But again, this is the time to do a budget if you haven't been doing it. I know it's going to be painful to kind of look at some of the things, and it's uncomfortable sometimes, but this is when you really need to know where the money is going from your bank account. Next slide, please. So obviously mortgage, rent, right? Those are the, for a lot of people, that's their number one expense every month. Fortunately, there are a lot of things that are happening to help people right now. So the biggest thing that I can stress is that you need to pick up the phone. You need to start calling, right? And I'm going to say that again for credit cards here in a little bit. This is the time where you really need to reach out to your mortgage lender or your landlord and ask what they're doing to help people right now. And a lot of companies, for example, Wells Fargo is granting an immediate 3-month mortgage payment suspension. They're not reporting past due payments to the credit reporting agencies. Ally Bank is offering payment deferrals for up to 120 days without late fees. BMO Harris is deferring payments for up to 3 months. Citi has, they have a hardship program. If you go to their website, you can find out more about that. And that's just a couple of the banks, but a lot of the lenders are really putting out some good programs to help people and kind of give them some flexibility during this time. And then same thing with landlords. There's plenty of stories that are coming out of landlords. One I heard yesterday was that somebody that owns a 12-building multifamily unit has waived all rent until July, which is incredible. Now, obviously, that might not be happening for everybody, but you want to call your landlord, your apartment company, and see what they're offering for you and see if they can defer payments. And then I've got some resources. All the stuff is on millennialmoneyman.com, but we have, if you've been laid off or furloughed, we have a full list of what you can do, resources, things you should look into. And then also, if you're having trouble paying bills, we have a whole list of government resources and non-government resources to help you get help. That's not my Pilates reminder. I would hurt myself if I did Pilates. So next one, contact your credit card companies, right? This is a big one. Credit card debt is one of the main factors for kind of putting people in a bad situation because of the interest rates, right? You're talking 15, 20% interest rates or more. So again, pick up the phone and call your credit card company. A lot of companies right now are doing things to help. American Express is waiving interest in late payment fees. Bank of America has a request form for payment deferrals. Now, remember, a deferral just pushes it down the road, but it can give you some immediate liquidity if you need it as far as not having to make payments. Chase is helping customers by waiving fees. They're extending payment dates. Citi is letting people pause credit card payments and extending lines of credit, which I would recommend you try not to use if you can. But and then Capital One has an assistance program to waive interest and fees, and Discover can help with payment timing. So whether you bank with a credit union or one of the big box banks, I would definitely call or look at the website and see what options you have for credit cards. And to continue on with credit cards, next slide, please. I saw a lot of questions about how can I use this time to pay off debt. Right. I know some of you, obviously a lot of people don't have that ability, but if you do have the ability to continue to pay and you want to kind of, chip away at your debt while you can. One thing I would consider is a transfer to a 0% interest card, a 0% interest balance transfer. Basically what this is you're taking your current balance and you're moving it over to a credit card that has 0% interest, right? And so that will allow you to make a bigger chunk or take out a bigger chunk of your debt with your payments. But there are a couple things to keep in mind with this. You wanna look for a card that offers 0% interest for a long period. And when I say a long period, I mean somewhere in the range of 12 to 18 months. Because the way that these work, if you move your credit card debt over to a 0% interest card and it's only, let's say, 6 months, after that period is over, you're gonna be looking at probably a variable APR of like 15 to 22%. So it's going to go up after that introductory rate. So you want to see if you can get something that's longer, 12, 15, 18 months. You also want to make sure that it's not going to cost you more to move over to a balance transfer card. Some cards have high transfer fees and interest rates that can kind of negate that short-term benefit of 0% interest. So you want to make sure you really look at the cardholder agreement. You'll need to make sure you know what you actually need to do to make the minimum payment each month to qualify for the 0% interest. If there's late payments or you have a check balances or something like that, they can revoke that 0% interest fee and go to the higher rate. So you want to know exactly how that works. And then the unfortunate reality, you will have better options if you have a higher credit score. And I know, if you don't have a higher credit score right now, you're probably thinking that doesn't help me. What my advice would be to everybody that's listening right now is to start tracking your credit score, because it does make a difference when you're trying to get these credit cards or, you know, personal loans or anything like that. You can get better rates. I personally use Credit Karma. I'm not endorsed by them or anything like that, but that's what I use to monitor my credit. And if you haven't ever done that before, you haven't ever looked at your credit, you might be surprised to find some things on there that are maybe delinquent payments that aren't correct, or somebody tried to steal your credit card information. There's a lot that looking at a free program like Credit Karma or Credit Sesame can be really helpful. It can help you build your credit score over the long term. So I would certainly recommend that. Next slide, please. So we also saw a lot of people wondering about side hustles, right? You know, that's one of the things that I cover in depth on Millennial Money Man. That's one of the areas of expertise that I do have. And right now, I'm not going to lie to you, it's a little bit limited as far as what you can do to make extra money. If you had asked me 2 months ago, I could have listed, you know, 50 or 60 different things that you can do. But there are still options right now if you're looking for a way to make extra money. And I would recommend, once we come out on the other side of this, multiple income streams can protect you in situations like this. I hope we never see something like this again. But if you do have a situation in the future where maybe you lose your job or you have to take a cut and pay, having those multiple income streams is really, really important. And there's a lot of different ways to do it. So some of the things I would be looking at, there are a lot of people that are just doing retail therapy right now, and they're buying a lot of stuff online. eBay sales are still very strong, so you can sell your stuff online. If you have furniture in your home, things like that, you can go to the Facebook Marketplace, eBay. There's a lot of free resources out there, a lot of free courses. I've actually got some resources on Millennial Money Man. Run Facebook ads for small businesses, but really more digital marketing for small businesses is going to be a really, really popular side hustle probably in the next few months. Obviously, small businesses are hurting right now, so this isn't going to help, you know, right now. But my prediction is that there's going to be an explosion in the amount of small businesses that need help getting people in the door. So there are plenty of courses that you can take, and even Facebook has a blueprint course on how to run Facebook ads for local businesses. So that's a potential side hustle that pays very well. Work as a proofreader, drive for Instacart, deliver for DoorDash right now is one that's highly in demand, right? And then teach English online with VIP Kid. That's a very popular one with APA readers. When we've talked about it in the past on the website, and essentially what you're doing is you're working with children overseas and you're doing lesson plan. You actually don't even have to do the lesson plan. There's a pre-made lesson plan for you through VIP Kid, and you're working one-on-one with students to teach them English. So it's the barrier to entry is very low. You have to have teaching experience, but that's a very, very wide ranging definition. You know, it could be if you ever taught a Sunday school class, that is teaching experience, and they're looking for plenty of people still right now. So I do have two resources, Best Side Hustles from Home and Side Hustle, that you can go to on the website. And it's going to go through all of the possible side hustles out there right now that you can use. And then last slide, I think. So I'm available for any questions that you guys have. I know there's, you know, several hundred people that signed up for this webinar. My assistant's probably not going to be super happy that I'm doing this, but feel free to send an email to Bobby at Millennial Money Man, and we will point you in the right direction. If there's a resource or an article on the site, if you have a specific question, we're happy to help you with that. And then the one thing I would recommend for everybody here, there's actually a Millennial Money Man community on Facebook. It's got about 13,500 people in it, and I highly recommend that you join that. It's free. Anybody can join. All you have to do is go to facebook.com/group/millennialmoneyman, and any money question that you have, all you have to do is post it in there, and the community will answer it for you. And it's a very safe place. We don't allow people to, you know, bully people or make fun of people for different situations that they have financially. Everybody's in this together. And I think you'll really enjoy it if you join the group. So you will have to answer a couple of entrance questions so we can make sure that you're not a spammer, you know. But outside of that, then our admins will let you in. And again, I'm sure they'll be really happy with me for pointing a couple hundred people to it, but we're happy to have you there. So just some resources for you. And that's all I have, guys.
Wow, this is really tremendous. So we've got about 7 minutes. We will end on time. And I've received a number of questions, both from our registrants and from our people that joined us today that may have had questions based on some of the things that Bobby, Kenneth, and Alex were saying. So I will start with a couple that I think are probably more related to the federal loan. Is there, and I believe the answer is yes, but both undergraduate and graduate loans will be sort of paused during this period of time.
Yes, that's correct.
Thanks. And can you speak again, because a number of questions came up even during the webinar, any chance of debt being erased altogether? There have been certainly a lot of calls from advocacy coalitions for it.
Altogether, period, that's unlikely. As I said, there have been some conversations of potentially, you know, at least $10,000 worth of debt or at least $30,000 worth of debt, but I have not seen anything beyond that, and even that is going to be a difficult lift. But altogether, just being completely frank, that's unlikely.
Thanks. Is there any, so a couple of questions were about what are the cons here, right? Sometimes when you get something for free, we're taught to always know that there could be a string attached. And some of the questions have to do with that very notion. Is there anything we should be wary of? Is there a con to accepting this pause? Should we continue to pay on principal if we have money that we can afford to pay on our loans during this time, speaking about federal loans? And then maybe I'll turn it to Alex after you, Kenneth, if there's any implications for private paying during this time.
I don't necessarily think there's a con to taking it, but if you feel like you want to continue making payments, I'm not really here to give financial advice in that regard, but if you feel that you're comfortable making payments and you want to go ahead and do it, you can. Like I said, this is an automatic action that's being taken by the department, so if you do want to continue making them, you would have to contact your servicer, let them know that you want to continue doing it. And then once the interest that accrued before March 13th is paid off, the rest of the payments will be applied to the principal. So if that's something that you think you're comfortable with doing in this 6-month period, that is really your choice. But I don't think there's necessarily a con to taking this, you know, and using this waiver.
Thank you. Alex or Bobby, do you want to add on to that or have any related thoughts about making loan payments during this time?
I guess just on the private side, I mean, we are offering the additional 3 months of forbearance. So, you know, you certainly do not have to make payments if you're under financial duress, but we certainly would welcome them if you wanted to. You know, like Kenneth said, it's really at the borrower's, at your discretion. I'm sure Bobby has some thoughts on whether that's a prudent move at this point or if you're better off, you know, building that emergency savings account. So I'll let him comment on that.
Yeah. And I mean, really, that's what it comes down to. If you do have an emergency savings account, if you have an emergency savings fund and it's fully funded, you have 3 to 6 months of expenses, you know, and if you do have that, sure, you know, go ahead and continue to pay off debt. If you want to try to advance that debt payoff date. But if you don't, this is a time where we don't know how long this is going to go on. You know, we hope it's over shortly. But my recommendation would be, if you are feeling like you're pinched and you don't have enough money right now, I would be trying to put it into a savings account if you can, and take advantage of some of these waivers.
Thank you. And this is a question for somebody who is already repaying private loans. Is there any federal benefit that one can take advantage of right now?
Not currently in terms of private loans. So these loans are, you know, totally separate of any federal entity. So there hasn't been any legislation passed. Kenneth, I know you mentioned there's been some talk about like a wide sweeping pause on private loan payments, but to this point, it really varies by your lender. Like I said, we're currently offering the 3-month added forbearance, but you have another 12 months that come on the loan. But no, currently there are no federal benefits associated with private loans.
Yeah, I mean, that's correct. And some members of Congress have asked private entities to delay payments, but they haven't actually legislated on that at the federal level. And I don't believe that's going to be the case. I do know that, in, like I said, in New York State, I believe for New York borrowers, those private entities are delaying payments, but that is really in that state, and that's really up to the discretion of the private lender. So I don't know if that's going to extend to other states, but at the moment, there is no federal action on this other than calls on these private organizations to banks mainly to potentially delay payments, but they would have to decide that on their own.
Thank you. A question for Alex. One of our listeners was looking on Laurel Road's website and wondering if there's any consultation offered for APA members to reduce the feeling of all these different student loan options out there.
Yeah, so you're welcome to contact our customer service team. I mean, they are, to be totally clear, they're not financial advisors, but would be more than happy to chat about your options. The phone number for our customer service center is 855-245-0989.
Thank you. And a question perhaps for Bobby, is there, there's a lot of information being put out there to help people deal in the times of COVID. And one of the secondary effects of this is people feeling overwhelmed with options. Do you have any advice to speak to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, as far as just being overwhelmed, like with too many different things to choose from, what I would do is just make sure you're going to trusted sources of information, going to sources that are legitimate. We're working really hard at the APA to make sure that we're getting out content for you to help you during this time, and something that we've been talking about, you know, back and forth a lot. So what I would suggest is keeping an eye on the APA website. We're going to be putting out more content. They're really, you know, just as an outside, kind of like an outsider and working with the APA, what they're doing, I think, is incredible with these webinars and with the information that they're putting on the website. So I think that, I'm not just saying this because they pay me to write for them. I think that it's an incredible resource, and I really think you should lean on that because they do a great job and it's very detailed information.
Thank you. I appreciate all of our panelists for joining us today. Certainly, we appreciate our audience members for being a part of this webinar for the whole hour. We've reached the end of our time. I just go down the line and see if anyone has any final thoughts or reminders for those that have tuned in today.
I just think, as others have said, you know that you're not alone in this. That everyone is struggling in various different kind of respects, and that at the federal level, at least in terms from APA side, we are advocating on your behalf. You are a priority for us, and we want to do the right thing, and we want to encourage the people in power to continue doing the right thing.
Yeah, I would say just, you know, like everybody said here, this is something nobody really saw coming, and it's been kind of an extraordinary thing that we hope never happens again. My recommendation would be to take what you learn from this, because all of us are learning a whole lot. And from the personal finance perspective, try to apply it once we get on the other side of this. I know a lot of people were probably living with less of a cushion of cash than they ever thought they would need. So I would recommend, you know, if once we get on the other side, start saving more, start budgeting more, start doing what you can. We obviously can't prevent things like this from happening, but you can certainly work on being more prepared next time. And I think all of us are going to be, you know, looking at doing that. So try to look at this as an opportunity, at least on the other side, when we do get there.
Yeah, I would echo that. I mean, obviously this is unprecedented, as everyone has said, and it's creating a lot of financial duress, but there's also been some opportunities that have come in light of it, like this student loan interest waiver. You know, nothing like that has ever happened. So again, you know, going back to what Bobby said, do your research, go to credible sources, you know, be prepared to capture some of these opportunities which exist right now.
Thanks again to all of you for your time. Wanted to remind folks to check out the website that's listed on your screen now. It's sort of APA's homepage for all things related to this pandemic and the resources that we're amassing and putting out there. For the students that have attended, I've also pasted in a Facebook group that you can join to support one another during this time. We've got one webinar in the works that might be especially relevant to you. It's coming up on May 20th. It's about entering the job market or changing jobs during the pandemic. So we're excited to be putting that together, as well as a whole webinar series with this one kicking off today. I'm really grateful again that we could be able to provide this to you. I wish you a lot of luck. If you didn't get your questions answered, we're going to do our best to fan out the questions to those experts, and they'll be in touch with you directly. And a recording will be made available and emailed to you shortly after, most likely later today. So with that, I'll say thanks again, and I wish you all a good day. Stay healthy.